so good, I feel so numb.
And now, from the Cave of Wonders and recorded live in the presence of gods, welcome to the Rain Man Show.
All right, hello everybody, we're back. Rain Man Show on a Tuesday evening, October 24th.
Oh boy.
Just a few days away from my favorite holiday.
You actually like a holiday?
No. Come on.
Okay. Well,
you couldn't tell there was sarcasm there?
Yeah, I had a little bit of hope for you.
How long have you known me? You think I like Halloween out of all the possibilities?
Demanding things from you?
And shitty looking yards. I mean, I'm getting fines because I have weeds that are a couple inches. No. Yes, the other week it was really bad. But the fines came when the weeds were only just yay high,
right,
a couple inches. Meanwhile, you have my neighbor across the way having cotton literally all spread all over his bushes.
Right.
So that, you know, because that's so cleverly.
It's a cobweb, Michael.
Yeah.
Come on.
Cleverly looks like spider webs. But that's okay. You can have a shitty looking yard for the entire holiday season, but you can't have weeds that are more than 2 inches.
No, and you should be ashamed, and you should feel bad.
You can have someone who looks like a dead zombie with his head cut off, and he's disemboweled right across the street in my yard where my kid can see something very grotesque and violent, but you can't have weeds 2 inches in length.
No. Halloween.
You can have shitty Christmas lights. Mexicans don't know how to decorate correctly. They always like those weird festive colors. Then they have like the chili pepper Christmas lights. That's not festive.
Right.
But that's okay. But 2 inches or more,
you know, it explains
for weeds, Thomas,
lot.
And that's just not okay.
It explains why your house never looked festive during the holidays. Like, I didn't realize it until I think 2 years ago that you didn't celebrate anything. And then it makes sense looking back in hindsight why you had no fucking decorations.
Yeah. Because I hate it.
Your kid must have fun during,
you know,
December.
What? I take him places. He gets toys. He gets all the things
just
he can possibly.
Tree.
Just no shitty Halloween. And no son of mine wants to celebrate Halloween.
Oh, because
he's
well.
Rised above.
He's above that.
He's risen above it.
He's ascended.
Yes. He is a Flores. He's better than.
I see.
Yeah. Privilege.
What privilege. Kind of privilege?
Not white privilege.
Exactly.
All right. So lots of things have happened over the last couple of weeks, Thomas.
Yeah. The world's gone nuts as usual.
As usual. I always love taking a break because then we just come back fully stockpiled with enough content to just spend the next 6 or 7 hours in the studio if we wanted to. In fact, that's something you and I were talking about. We're not even getting through our topics anymore.
No, we're not.
Because there's just so much. And we're both like, well, that means we could probably do, you know, a weekly show. Yes, that's something we'd like to do.
A daily
but
show?
That's just not going to. Oh, no, we already do a weekly show, huh?
Like you say.
All right. So weekly would be once a week.
Right.
And
naturally, that's what
daily,
that means.
Daily.
Every day.
Every day.
Right.
Typically Monday through Friday.
Right.
Now, bi-weekly is every other week.
Correct.
Annually. It's once a year. See, I know things. Don't try to scoff at me, Andrew.
Shaw.
Took a half second to remember which one you were yelling at.
Yeah. Andrew just came in here full of.
He was angry. He was ready.
He was
not,
ready.
Not angry,
I think
but like
he,
ready and flowing with autism.
Yeah, flowing with autism. The autism was flowing strong. He was. I can't talk tonight already. Already, I can't speak tonight.
He brought
started.
His cheese and he had a beard growing.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's what threw me off. I think for the
cheese.
Start of the show,
his beard.
Well, he come not the beard. I could deal with his beard if you get what I'm saying. But it's the cheese. He walks in with the cheese, which we already know that's an ongoing thing. I've asked people not to come in.
Don't bring food
to the studio with food that smells.
I eat out in the kitchen.
You eat in the kitchen.
That?
You stay over there.
Yep.
Or people can bring in granola bars, you know, things that
Fried
don't smell.
Snacks. Bus approved.
Yeah. We're just like a school here.
Right.
I don't
Someone's
want.
Someone's going to get written up.
I just don't want smelly food in my studio. And he walks in, and I'm not exaggerating, Thomas. You were here. You know it. He walks in with cheese that literally smells like open asshole. And I'm not exaggerating.
But Andrew's already used to that smell.
Fair enough.
And so he didn't notice any difference.
In my defense, I did not know that it was the smelly cheese.
And maybe he's living vicariously through eating out that cheese. He's thinking he can stick his nose in an asshole someday.
It's the same thing.
He's working his way to there.
Yeah.
Up there.
It's a step.
Yeah.
Down there?
Step.
Yeah, down there. See, Andrew's not going to disagree.
He knows.
And I am a fan of cheese. I like drinking wine. I like having cheese. And I don't mind having slightly aged cheese. But I also don't want to feel like I'm eating a dirty vagina while I'm enjoying cheese and wine. Apparently, right. It doesn't bother Andrew because it smelled so bad. I walked down the hallway and the odor was following me.
It haunted you. And it'll haunt your dreams. And it'll haunt this room.
It reminded me of the Comic-Con. When we went to Comic-Con and the essence of Andrew was following everybody who walked past our booth at the Comic-Con was walking by and sniffing their underarms because they could have swore it was themselves because it was so bad. And that's what I was doing with this cheese. I was walking to the bathroom down the hall thinking I smelled like dirty open ass.
Coincidentally.
Yeah.
Did you?
No. And then we find out it's Andrew's cheese. It's right. So disgusting.
I do want to point out it's not disgusting because Tony enjoyed my cheese. He liked it.
Yeah.
You want to rephrase that?
Yeah, I think he's just being I think he's being polite. I think he's trying
Tony's
to
Tony's being polite.
Gloves off. Yeah. Gloves off. Was it nice cheese?
Yes, it was. It wasn't dick cheese.
Okay. It was not. It was no smegma.
So you're saying that it doesn't taste the way it smells?
No, it doesn't taste the way it smells.
How is that even possible?
Dude, the smellier the cheese, the better.
I would... Listen, you're not educating me on cheese. I understand how cheese works. I know just because you stop at Walgreens, the corner market, and come in with $5 cheese doesn't mean you're uppity.
You tried to school.
Are you kidding me?
I
have to spend $5
cheese.
On cheese. Are you kidding me? I'm broke, bitch.
Exactly.
Get that out of the bargain bin.
He's probably
AKA the dumpster.
Yeah. Hey, homeless Tom.
Yeah.
Did you store that cheese for me? Did you save that for me?
I saved it.
Yeah. Making deals with homeless. Hot dumpster sacks in the back. Yeah. You're doing it all wrong. I'll save this cheese for you. But you gotta do something for me first, Andy.
Yeah? What do I gotta do?
Oh.
He just falls right into that role playing immediately.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
There's other things you'll talk about and he'll get uncomfortable with. Yeah. That, not a problem.
Yeah.
Homeless man dumpster sex. Sure. Got it.
And the only reason why I'm covering this right now is because I'm trying to allow Andrew to work through his autism beginning so that it doesn't derail the rest of the show.
Right.
Because I really didn't want to get into smelly cheese.
No, but it happened.
Listen, I'm a team player, and I understand the host that's in this studio, and if I can help prevent forest fires, then I will. I'll do my part. All right, so I did have a meeting, Thomas, with the boss lady over at Wax On, Wax Off.
Yes.
That's your official place where you go get your asshole waxed.
Right.
Speaking of stinky asshole,
I am always clean.
Well, according to
unlike
you,
the cheese.
We'll talk to her soon enough.
All right.
We had lunch. Very nice lady. And this is the sponsor that I was talking about a couple weeks ago.
Right.
It's a local place in Tempe, Wax On, Wax Off, that we're going to be doing some business with. And to kind of kick things off, we're going to be doing a live video broadcast of somebody getting a Brazilian wax. Now, right. Obviously, we can't show everything.
Right.
So we're gonna get creative with it. However, we are going to get down and dirty in the studio. We're looking at two dates, either November 7th or November 14th.
Okay.
One of those two days will be the day where we broadcast live the entire show. We will then release the video on demand free of charge for everybody because it will be a sponsored bit. See, this is what happens when we get sponsors. I can give more shit
give away
for free.
Things for free.
And yeah, it's gonna be fun. And I'm not gonna say who's getting waxed yet. I want to keep that up. I want that to be a surprise.
Right. Well, you want them to tune in.
Yeah, it's gonna be a surprise who's gonna get waxed, but it is gonna be very, very sexy. We're gonna make sure. We're gonna make sure it's very sexy. Oh.
As we always do here on Rain Man.
Oh yeah.
We're known for our
sex. We're known for that. Smelly cheese.
And sex.
And sexuality. Yeah.
Yep. There we go.
Better than sexy cheese.
Yeah. What?
I don't. Why? Why would you indulge that?
I don't know. Now, when I sat down for lunch, I mean, this is a thing that I do. You know, I've done it my entire life. I have business meetings. I talk to people. I sell myself. I sell my business. This is nothing new. However, I found myself immediately a bit insecure just because I know through other conversations, she wants me to try the product before it's sold on our network. And I said, well, that's only fair. I need to know what it's about. I mean, if I'm going to be taking this company, hopefully wax on, wax off to the next level via our network, that I need to know what we're talking about. I mean, you know what we're talking about. You've used the product. And I know she's been trying to wrangle me in there for the last month. And she says, I'm very nice. And she does have that disposition where she is forthcoming and you feel very comfortable around her, which I think you have to have that type of personality. So she does have that welcoming, oh, it's okay.
Yeah.
And she has all her well-chosen words of things to make you feel okay about it.
And I'm just not.
Well, we talked about people getting aroused and unintentionally.
So she had that conversation with you.
Yeah. And I said, ooh, that happened. She said, well, unintentionally, it's okay. It's very natural. I'm like, I felt like I was talking to my mother about, you know, puberty and masturbation.
Right.
I felt like I was having that conversation again.
It does feel like part therapy, talking to her like a therapist.
Yeah.
She has that same demeanor.
And I think you have to, right? To be in that type of business, you have to be very open. You have to be... what's the word I'm looking for?
Honest and forthcoming.
Yeah. Sincere.
Sincere.
And that's exactly how she comes off. She's a very nice lady.
Yeah.
However, I always have, you know, stories to tell when I talk to people, because that's how I am. I start conversing, and it's funny because my insecurity immediately took over and we're sitting down, we're having a conversation, and I'm choking a little bit on, we're drinking juice. We went to a juice bar. Where it serves all, you know, like organic juices.
Right.
And I start choking a bit because my throat has been very sensitive lately due to the fact that I scorched my throat ever since camping, which I don't know if people have noticed. My voice is a little more scratchy. It hasn't healed.
Okay.
And I'm a little concerned because this is my moneymaker. You know, I need to be able to talk. It's a terrible sounding voice, but I still need it. You got to work with what you have, Thomas.
Right. Right. And when you only have 4 inches, losing another inch is a dramatic effect.
Exactly. You get where I'm coming from. So I'm a little nervous about my voice.
Okay.
And I just brought it up in conversation because I started choking in front of her at this juice bar. So I just brought up the story and told her, yeah, I've been struggling with my throat lately. It's really affecting my voice and the way I communicate and talk and my actual voice itself. My throat is completely scorched. I burnt it while I was camping. Due to extremely hot coffee. I didn't realize it was my mom does hardcore cooking out there when we go camping, and the coffee pot is just on the fire. It's just sitting on the fire. So we pull it off, we put it into the cup, and I wasn't prepared for scorching hot coffee, and I didn't feel the heat right away. So I swallowed. Yeah, I swallowed, Andrew. He got really giddy. And it burned immediately as soon as it hit the esophagus. And then I was like, okay, it's over. I'm done. I'm okay.
Nope.
And then it hit right here, the sternum area, where it went down. And I felt it burning in there, and there was nothing I could do. I thought my insides were... I was screaming. I dropped to my knees.
There were tears.
I made sure I faced towards Mecca. I was praying to Islam.
You said goodbye to your family.
I did. I thought I was going to explode. It was so painful. And ever since then, I'm trying to nurse my throat.
Okay.
And I tell her this story. She's all, and this is my insecurity to a perfect example of my insecurity with my voice. She's all, so is your voice usually much deeper then? And I was like, and my mind immediately went to, okay, she's been listening to our shows, which I know she has. I know she has. And there is that stereotype of the classic radio guy, how he has to have that voice.
Yeah.
The very deep Thomas Calley voice, if you will.
Okay.
You know, which your voice is natural. You're not trying to make it that way. Many people in the business try to make their voice sound like that. I'm not going to do that because that's not what brings in audiences. The way you sound and how sultry you sound is not what's going to bring in an audience. It's your personality and your content is what will bring in your audience. Content is key.
Right.
You see how I'm really focusing on that?
Right. Yes.
Not the voice. Fuck the voice.
Right. It's not what I do. It's what you do.
Yes, it's about content. All right, people?
Understood. That didn't help your confidence that day, though.
No, I feel like I'm trying to, even right now, I feel like I'm trying to, convince myself. I'm trying to convince myself right now on the air. Wow.
You brought this up just to make yourself feel better around the public.
Mm-hmm. I felt really insecure, and I know she probably didn't mean it that way. I guess at least that's what my psychologist says, that she didn't mean it that way. But that's what I took it as. Like, oh, she's been listening to the show, and I know she really likes Thomas. She's really connected to him. She's, you know, she loves him as a client, and she probably assumed that I was going to sound as sultry as Thomas, and she listens. She'll, this guy sounds like a nasally 12-year-old. I mean, it felt like the first time I was going to have sex. And I think all males, when they're about to have sex for the first time, are a little concerned about their penis size, even when you kind of know your penis is okay. You kind of, no one's dumb. Everyone understands, I'm okay looking. But that first time.
Oh, yeah.
You were nervous, right? A little bit with the penile?
Oh, dude, every time.
Yeah. He was like, I hope it measures up. You know, do I look small? Come on, get bigger. You're smacking it on the wall. You're flicking it.
Jesus.
You're doing anything you can. I mean, if you're Andrew, you're looking at gay porn. I mean, you do whatever you have to. And that's kind of how I felt when I heard.
But with your voice?
Yeah, with my voice. Right. And it set the entire precedence. Now I'm down messing over words.
Precedent.
Yeah, entire precedent of the conversation, because then I feel like I'm justifying from the very beginning. Like
it's normally much better.
Yeah, it's cold. It's cold. Yeah, I felt like I was on a date.
Yeah.
You know, she probably wished she swiped right.
You'll be fine. Don't worry. So are you going to do it, though? That's the question.
Waxing?
Yeah.
No.
You're not going to do it.
I'm going to get my arms waxed. I'll get my armpits waxed because I already shave anyways.
Okay. It's worth it.
I mean, one time I had my ex shave me back there once, and then it never happened again. It was very, very awkward. I was like, I missed a spot. Can you get that for me?
Very traumatizing.
For me. You talk about vulnerable.
Yeah, I can see you have an issue with that.
Oh, I was so vulnerable, and I didn't think about it till afterwards.
Right.
Because I'm like, oh, damn, I missed a spot. I can feel it, and I can see it kind of. I'm like, but I can't reach it. My arms are – I was doing steroids back then, so my arms were too, like big, and I wasn't flexible enough, so I couldn't even reach. So I'm like, I can't do it. I got a mirror. You know, I got one of those
– system.
You were going to call 911?
I had a mirror.
Right.
I had a wall mirror. And then I had an actual,
hand mirror.
And I was trying to get really, you know, look, I spaced my legs apart and I bent down a little bit so I could see my ass. I was like, and I'm like, all right, I think I got all the hair. And then I saw a spot.
Uh-huh.
So then I got a little closer to the mirror. I brought that mirror back, the hand mirror.
Right.
I brought it back a little further and I'm like, yeah, definitely missed a spot. I can see that. And then I'm over with my right hand and I'm just like trying to get it. I couldn't, so I, you know,
it had her do
I
it.
Had I needed to call in help,
and ever since then,
yeah,
never again. I don't know. I get what you're saying, but honestly, that whole story right there shows me that it's worth doing it because the shaving is far more involved, and it doesn't last anywhere near as long. The shaving will last anywhere between 2 or 3 days if you're lucky. If you do the wax, that'll last at least a week, if not longer. And it won't grow back as strong as it once did.
So my question is whether, so we know, he knows who's getting waxed, but does the person getting waxed know they're getting waxed? That's what I want to know.
Who knows? It'll be a surprise for everybody.
Yeah.
It'll be a surprise for her. It'll be a surprise for that person.
It'll be
a surprise for the fans.
Show up and just, hey, you drop trowel.
Andrew, exactly. Have you ever been waxed?
I have not.
Because I know you have.
I've buzzed my butt, but I have not waxed my butt.
Because I know you had that question when you first became a permanent fixture on the show. You actually specifically asked, have you ever waxed your butt?
Right.
And obviously there's some curiosity there. So is that something that you would be interested in doing, is getting a full-on wax?
Not in
your butt.
Go ahead.
Not of
have
my.
Have you ever waxed your butt?
Not of my butt area. But I'll get a wax. We'll do like a chest pits, you know. I'll do
the
balls,
glamour spots.
I don't want to do balls. Nah.
It doesn't hurt that bad.
I I don't believe you.
All right.
You get a bolt through your cock. I don't believe you.
You know, I would counter argument that, but you're right. I can't really come back from that one. So
did you notice his eye flicker?
I did, yeah.
Like when he said you got a bolt through your cock, he actually looked at
the
your cock.
Audience knew, and they're not even able to see anything.
Yeah, I know.
And then he got embarrassed and he like looked out.
Oh god, no, yeah.
Don't make eye contact. Don't make eye contact. Whatever you do, don't make eye contact, please. Very embarrassed right now. I looked at his cock. Oh goodness.
Oh goodness.
Oh goodness.
Oh jeez.
He got really giddy, his face, when he said it. He's like, I finally had a reason to look.
Oh, like he needed a reason.
And not be judged. Yeah. So yeah, dealing with that wasn't the funnest of scenarios.
But you got through it.
I got through it and the lady was nice.
Right.
But I didn't make it awkward immediately. Because from that very point with the throat issue, all I was doing was trying to get myself out of that hole. I was trying to get myself out of the hole, and I don't think I ever managed.
The meeting was 2 hours long, an hour and 45 minutes of which was you trying to defend.
Yeah. Trying to justify and fix what I said.
Your voice isn't that bad.
Oh, thank you, Thomas.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I was waiting for about 20 minutes.
You're welcome. You're welcome. I knew it.
You wanted reassurance.
But I still am far better than Ron Burgundy, I would have to say. And also other announcers out there, because this is a perfect example how voices don't mean you're the best. And voices, see, this whole show now is designed to defend myself.
Right. From the ground up.
Yeah. Created the entire show, an entire hour and a half to be about how voice doesn't matter in radio.
And here's 108 Reasons Why by Michael Flores.
All right. So Fox Sports announcer fail. Was something straight out of Anchorman.
I've done that. We all know if you listen to Supernatural that I've done that. I've had Ron Burgundy moments where I'm reading the notes verbatim, mm-hmm. and they'll be old or a typo, and I'll fuck it up. I'll pull that move. So Mike's got me there at the very least. He doesn't straight read like a dumbass.
Yeah.
But apparently you can get a job and that doesn't affect you if you work at Fox Sports, apparently.
You know what? The audio speaks for itself. During a recent football game, he actually reads the teleprompter. But not just what he's supposed to read. He reads the directions.
Oh, like actions?
He reads what he's supposed to do as well. And he doesn't catch it. He's an idiot.
On the Visa Halftime Report, Kurt, Terry, Howie, Michael, and Tony look on graphic for the final two bullet points.
What an idiot.
Like, hey, there's a pause there, too. He's like, oh, this is different. I'm going to keep reading it, though.
He didn't even call himself out. Is he hoping that, like, the millions of people who tune in, like, didn't catch it?
I think he's hoping that they'll throw a graphic up on the screen so that people will then, oh, that's what he's talking about.
No, they're too busy laughing in the back. Like, oh, you fucking idiot. This is why I don't feel like they have true talent.
No, they don't. They just were there first.
Their talent is they know how to read well. They're not Bobby and they're not Andrew. They know how to read very well. And that's it. They can't. You throw anything their way and they're
anything
confused.
More complex.
If you mess up the ant line, they're looking for the line. They're like, oh, God, where do we go? Where do we go? Please spell it out for me.
I'm lost.
You imagine not having any type of creative freedom. You're literally a monkey. You're just being told what to do.
I would hate that.
And you still can't do your job right.
Well, so you're better than that. That's something, right?
Halftime report. Kurt, Terry, Howie, Michael, and Tony look on graphic for the final two bullet points.
It's still funny every time.
Well, sometimes young offensive tackle, right?
I just wanted to hear, well, shit. Like, I just wanted to hear that. We cut to commercial.
Oh, man.
Look on graphic for the...
See, his voice is spot
it's
on.
Great.
But he apparently can't do his job, and he's been doing it for 40 years.
Final two bullet points.
Well, sometimes young offensive tackle right there.
Look on graphic for the final two bullet points. Look on graphic for the final two bullet points.
What a tool. Yeah.
So that's the bar you got to meet.
They can read.
There you go.
Listen, I may not have the best voice for a lot of reasons, especially over the last couple weeks because I burnt and scorched my throat.
Right. But you can read.
Yeah.
And that's something.
Yeah. More professional broadcasting fuck-ups this week as well. Al Michaels makes a... I want to say, I wouldn't want to say it too soon of a joke on Weinstein. However, he did do it on broadcast television, and it was only a few days after the entire thing started unraveling in Hollywood. And personally, I wasn't offended. I thought it was kind of funny, actually. But this is what happens. This is what happens when you don't read from the teleprompter, when you don't do what the suits say upstairs.
Yeah.
I don't care what you do. All right, Al Michaels. I don't care if you accidentally read my directions I'm giving you, but never, ever take creative freedom.
Don't you fucking think?
Don't you do it. Because this is what happens.
Bradley, I mean, let's face it. The Giants are coming off a worse week than Harvey Weinstein. By 14 points.
Only my L.A. guy comes up with that
Well,
one.
You know.
There you go.
That's what he said. And immediately after...
That's not that bad.
No, it's nothing offensive, but he had to apologize because I'm sure the moment they went to commercial break, he was probably pulled to the back office and he got a talking to.
A tongue lash.
Because he accidentally, how dare you use your own creative freedom out there?
Who
read
said
that
you
teleprompter.
Could think? That is not in your contract. Who the fuck said you could think?
Exactly.
Yeah, it makes sense, though, if you're just told to say the same things over and over, read the prompter, explain what's happening on screen to people who can't watch for whatever reason. The second that you have that moment of freedom, his subconscious just went for something, just like screaming for help.
This is right after commercial break, he comes back.
Back in Denver. Sorry, I made a reference earlier before, trying to be a little flip about somebody obviously very much in the news all over the country and was not meant in that manner. So
and what is that voice as well? Like, he's doing an apology literally 5 minutes later.
Back in Denver. Sorry, I made a reference earlier before, trying to be a little flip about somebody obviously very much in the news all over the country and was not meant to.
Did he get like Southern suddenly as well?
No, that's that. I don't really care, but I guess I'll say this so I keep my job.
But also maintain broadcasting excellence,
right,
with the very enunciated words.
He probably, like, before then was, like, thinking, you know what? I don't really want to deal with the shit of everyone coming after me because I made some flippant remarks. So I'll just,
it wasn't even offensive. It wasn't even offensive, though.
But he said that
back in Denver, but he's gonna,
but honestly,
usually you don't talk when audio's playing.
Yeah, but honestly, you know, like, he'll end up getting blasted on social media for it.
He will, yeah, because that's just the world in which we live in these days. And that's the thing, is that, as Mike said, it's not even that bad of a comment. I mean, you're saying that this bad team's doing bad, and you compare it to someone else who's doing bad in the eye of the public recently. I mean,
and I don't want to make flippant of Harvey Weinstein, but you know, at the rate that the outrage is going on social media, it sounds like Harvey Weinstein molested the entire female population of Hollywood and maybe even the United States.
He might have. We haven't gotten the full final numbers.
At the rate that it's going, you know.
We haven't gotten the final numbers
yet.
He's
been really busy.
The point is that why offer an apology to a joke that he probably had written out the night before?
Yeah.
That this wasn't, you don't make an apology is when you use something by accident. Oh, I accidentally, you know, tripped and broke your camera.
Right.
I accidentally, you know, had sex with your wife. Okay.
Accidentally.
I accidentally fisted you.
Yeah. I was drunk. You don't accidentally tell a joke. This wasn't off the cuff. This was a well-written
joke.
Yes, you know he had this planned, but then he comes and apologizes. I just hate that type of stuff.
Don't
just
apologize
stand
for
by,
comedy.
Stand by your work. I know you're a broadcaster, and comedy isn't what you're supposed to be doing, but hey, it's done. Why apologize for it? Just, you didn't say anything offensive. You made a stupid joke.
Yeah.
The apologies are dumb.
You shouldn't have to apologize for jokes, I think, in the first place. They're jokes.
The only person who should be apologizing for their stupidity is Bob Costas. I mean, that guy can't even discuss sports anymore without putting his own spin on politics, his own personal politics. That's the problem. How come no one wrangles that guy in?
Yeah.
Every chance he gets, he'll talk about anti-guns or whatever else he feels like he's privileged to discuss on national football.
Maybe they're just waiting for him to leave.
I would rein him in. Give me an apology, Bob Costas.
No.
Should do.
I didn't think it was that bad, honestly. It's a joke. And that's the thing, is if we can't laugh at anything anymore to make a horrible situation even the little slightest bit less horrible, I mean...
Then this network is over.
Well, the world is over then.
Yeah. I don't know. I just feel like the Harvey Weinstein thing has been, has taken the world over for sure.
Yeah.
But at the same time, and it's definitely, I mean, holy shit. And we made some comments a couple weeks ago that everybody knew, and I still stand by that. I don't think people knew it was this, like this.
Yeah.
Tarantino made a comment, and his comment is pretty much how I looked at it as well. Meaning, I think there was this image of Weinstein, of Harvey. I think most people had this idea that he was that 1950s. And again, and Tarantino said the exact same things. Not that this makes it okay, but I think most people had the idea that it was kind of like that 1940s, 1950s executive who's chasing his secretary around the office. Like, that was the idea that most people might have had of, yeah, of Harvey, that he was a, you know, flirt and hit on women.
Yeah.
But I don't think people truly, not, I'm sure there were people, but I don't think as many people truly understood how bad and how much of a predator he truly was and is.
Right.
I can't imagine people actually knowing how horrible of a person he is and just keeping silent. Because if they were, then what does that say about the entire Hollywood industry? If they did really know how serious it was, alleged rape, masturbating in front of people, sexual assault, constant, incessant pursuing
of when, like, there's every actress.
I mean, listen, if anybody knew about this and didn't say anything, I mean, the whole Hollywood system should be looked at, because it's not just men who kept silent. There were women also, not the women who were victims. I'm not talking about that, and I have to specify that once again.
Right.
But there were women who weren't victims who also kept silent, just like the next director, like the next writer, who might have known, didn't have all the details, but might have heard things. Everybody is accountable for what was going on. I mean, the very phrase casting couch, where do you think that came from?
Not porn.
The casting couch has been a thing for countless years. You say casting couch, and people immediately know, oh, it's, hey, you want this part? Then you know what you need to do. Why do you think that was such a mainstream phrase?
Yeah. Where do you think that came from?
If people didn't know this was happening, then that phrase would be nothing when someone says it.
That's not the case.
Yeah. So there's a lot of blame to go around. A lot of blame.
Just take a look at the Coreys, Corey Feldman and Corey Haim. Like, they were talking about being passed back and forth between different Hollywood executives. Yeah. You know, Elijah Woods had run-ins with it for the kid from.
But luckily, he had the one ring to make him invisible.
Hey, the Rain Man Show will be right back.
Michael, stop.
No, that's how our fathers roll.
Snitches wanna try,
but
snitches wanna lie,
but
snitches wonder why,
but
snitches wanna die,
but
all I know is pain,
but
all I feel is rain,
but
how can I maintain,
but
the badness on my brain,
but
I resort to violence,
but
my killers move in silence,
but
like you don't know what I style,
but
so your killers are wild,
but
my dogs is with it,
but
you want it, come and get it,
but
took it, then we split it,
but
damn right we did it,
but
what the F you gon' do,
but
when we run up on you,
but
messing with the wrong crew,
but
don't know what we gon' do,
but
I'ma have to show,
but
how easily. You're listening to RM Channel 001.
All right. So, Thomas, a
yes,
couple different choices here.
Okay.
You know what? No choices.
Oh, shit. All right. Never mind then. I guess I'll shut my mouth.
All right. So, let's have a little fun.
Okay. At my expense, I'm assuming?
Of course. At
okay,
your expense. All
good.
Right.
Just wanted to know.
So, you're white.
Last I checked, yes.
Yeah. And Eminem is white.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
And he recently came out with a sweet freestyle that was kind of anti-Trump. And I have to be honest, I'm going to play it. I have to be honest, you know I'm a huge, huge Eminem fan.
Yeah, you are.
And this isn't the first time he's kind of mixed his talent with politics. He actually does a really good job with it. But I got to say that everyone got swept up in his freestyle, and it really wasn't that good compared to what he has done in the past. It almost felt like he just threw this to, well, it's a freestyle, so by definition,
yeah, by
it's
definition,
just, yeah, but it felt like there was any kind of thought process to it.
It's not rap god.
Yeah, Yeah.
It's not to Eminem standards.
It really isn't. And it felt kind of off for me. I didn't even feel like I didn't believe what he was saying. Like, I don't feel like he's as passionate about it as he has been in years past about certain things.
Okay.
However, I'm going to play it for you. And then I'm going to, you know what? I'm going to leave that part for a special treat. So here, let me play a little portion of his freestyle, which I know you heard it, right?
I have not.
You have not heard his freestyle?
No.
Okay, here we go.
Let's start this off. I forgot. Oh, yeah. That's an awfully hot coffee pot. Should I drop it on Donald Trump? Probably not, but that's all I got till I come up with a solid.
Now, I hope you're paying attention to how he's delivering it. Okay.
Got a hatchet like a damn Apache with a tomahawk. I'ma walk inside a mosque on Ramadan and say a prayer that every time talks, she gets a I'ma stop. But we better give Obama props, cause what we got in office now's a kamikaze that'll probably cause a nuclear holocaust. And while the drama pops and he waits for shit to quiet down, he'll just gas his plane up and fly around till the bombing stops. Intensity's heightened, tensions are rising.
Okay, so there's a... you get the gist, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I want you to open up those lyrics there.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, we're going to give this a try. You know, we've said this before. Does Thomas know? Does Thomas know rap? Does Thomas know that he's white? We're going to figure this out.
Okay.
Wait, what'd you say?
I can't open the lyrics. It's a locked document.
Oh, come on, Bob.
I requested access.
Did you actually request access?
I did, yeah.
Here, hold on a second.
You need permission.
You guys are going to have to talk why I...
I'm not white privileged enough to open this document.
So stupid.
You need to show us your white card.
All right, I'm gonna actually post it. I just copied it at the very, very bottom of the show notes.
Okay. I didn't realize that I needed to have special definitions to...
Yeah, you have to have a special white card.
Right.
To read white lyrics.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I'm supposed to read them out loud.
Just read through it for... I just want to kind of get a feel for it. Let the audience get a feel for what you can offer us in terms of rap skills.
I can't.
Now, Thomas, let's just take it one by one. You don't have to actually rap yet. Just read the lines, and I'm going to help you work through this, okay? Right?
Oh, God. This will be tragic. All right.
Let's try it out.
Are we starting at the very beginning where he doesn't know what he's starting with?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, let's read every line that you have there. Just be Ron Burgundy.
It's the calm before the storm right here. Wait, how was I going to start this off? I forgot. Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
You wanted it like Ron Burgundy, and we are going to go very white version Eminem. That's an awfully hot coffee pot. Should I drop it on Donald Trump? Probably not. But that's all I got till I come up with a solid plot. I got a plan, and now I got a hatchet. Like a damn Apache with a tomahawk, I'm
here,
a walker.
Let me help you out a bit. Ready?
Okay.
Let's start from the top.
Jesus. All right.
Here we go.
Why?
All right, here we go.
Why do you gotta hurt me like that?
Street cred. MC Cracker.
Go ahead, Tom.
It's the calm before the storm right here. Wait, how was I going to start this off? I forgot. Oh, yeah. That's an awfully hot coffee pot.
Now I want to see you bobbing. Come on.
Should I drop it on Donald Trump?
Get some
Probably
passion.
Not. But that's all I got till I come up with a solid plot. I got a plan, and now I got a hatchet. Like a damn Apache with a tomahawk. I'm a walk inside a mosque on Ramadan and say a prayer that every time Melania talks...
All right. Let's get a little more feeling in there. I want you to believe it. I want you to be... You grew up... on the other side of the tracks.
I didn't. There were no tracks. It was a suburban area.
You got your ass beaten every day.
Well, that's a different reason.
And I need you to feel it. Come on, you can do it. Here we go. Turn it back.
I don't think this is in me. Honestly.
You can do it. Just be passionate, like you're reading something. Be white.
I was being white.
Be Eminem white.
Not white? Oh, Jesus. It's the calm before the storm right here. Wait, how was I going to start this off? I forgot. Oh yeah,
he's still.
That whole part's awkward.
You gotta listen up. You gotta throw like an.
You are welcome to try, my friend. My blood is fucking whiteout ink. I swear to God.
Come on.
Your blood is.
I want to hear.
The rhythm is not in this man's blood.
It's not. It really isn't.
I think you might be a little too bisexual for this.
I might be. I'm more comfortable with that, surprisingly, than doing rap.
This might be a trait of bisexuality.
Start from the top.
I hate the top. Can't we start with the coffee pot bit?
Fine.
God damn it.
You could do it. Here, you know what? You know what I think it might be? Hold on. I think it might be. You might
by need, DNA?
Possibly. I think you might need another track. Let's try a different one. Maybe you need something a little more East Coast. Thomas has no idea what that even means.
No, I don't. Well, okay, geographically speaking.
Here we go. Let's do this.
Jesus, this is worse.
Here you go. Take it away, Thomas.
East Coast.
Come on, get into it.
That's an awfully hot coffee pot. Should I drop it on Donald Trump? Probably not.
He's like me. He's like me. He's freezing up when a bit happens.
I know what the problem is.
He's freezing up.
You have no soul.
I don't.
You have no soul.
I sold it long ago.
No, because by the way that you're like talking these lyrics, there's like no rhythm. There's no passion. No soul.
There really isn't.
See, Tony's just itching.
Let's have Tony do it.
He's
far more involved in the culture than I am.
Alright, let's give... He said no. Yeah.
He's just passing the buck back to me, you dickhead.
This is all about you.
I think we should have Andrew take a spin at it.
Yeah?
I'd love to hear
you
that.
Throw me down?
Yeah.
Yo, bring Tony, turn me up.
Just don't yell in the
right
mic.
Right there.
Just don't yell in the mic.
All right,
I don't want to do this.
That's fine. I would do the lyrics if I knew where they were.
He said we were at the bottom of the note.
We have Andrew. It's alright, Andrew. Ready? And do it.
Yo, is it calm before the storm right here?
Oh, my gosh.
Wait, hold on. I got a beat. I got a beat. That's an awfully hot coffee pot. Should I drop it on Donald Trump? Probably not.
Get away from the mic.
But that's all I got. So I'll come up with a solid plot.
All right, this is the
got a plan
bit.
And now yeah. I got a hatchet.
This is terrible.
Like a damn Apache with the... these lyrics are awful.
It's because you have to use the accent, and there's a certain vernacular that goes with it, so you have to
be Eminem.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's pretty much that.
Yeah. His lyrics are bad, though. His rhyming is awful. He's rhyming mid-line and then changing cadence halfway through.
It's a freestyle. Give the man a break. Although, I have to say, this is probably his...
It's fucking awful.
This might be one of his worst songs or freestyles I've ever heard. That's why I kind of was surprised how... I think, unfortunately,
the
internet loved it so much just because it was anti-Trump, which is a little disappointing. Mm-hmm. I mean, he went to town on Bush relentlessly.
Yeah.
He dropped that one on Trump.
The only thing is that
he could have done better for who he is.
I feel like him going against Bush was him going against the norm. Like he was the counterculture. Now this is him among many. And that's kind of maybe that's why it's not as much impactful. Of a novelty. I feel like everyone's saying what he's saying.
Yeah.
You know,
it doesn't feel special. And even for him, because he is a great rapper and a great artist, it feels, and admittedly, it's a freestyle. And as we've shown on the show tonight, I cannot do any better.
I think what would help.
But it feels not as good as he could have done.
I think what would help for you, Thomas, is that you write your own freestyle.
Oh.
No.
Bobby could help you out.
You really think he can write his own freestyle?
I think
that, you know, like maybe reading another person's freestyle might be it's not passionate enough. No soul for Thomas. He's gotta come up with this freestyle like Eminem does, like from the heart. You got to do the same thing.
He's like Mekhi Phifer from 8 Mile. He's like, you could do it, man.
Yeah.
Oh man. Anyways, I don't know.
I get what you're saying. I think it has some validity to that statement because it is the same as everyone else is saying now. He's not going against norms or saying anything different. He's saying the same thing that everyone is, which is they hate Trump.
Yeah, you know. God. Yeah. You should have known I was going to be here.
Hello, Mr. President.
Yeah, I'm here. And I'm a little disappointed with his lyrics. It's just not good.
Were you listening to the song?
It's below average. Let's be honest. I'm just going to be truthful here. I mean, we've heard better. I mean, you were doing much better, Eminem, when you were talking about how miserable you were with your mother and pretending to love your daughter so much. I mean, that's when you really shot. I mean, the contradictory messages of your poetry, as you so call it. I mean, that's the genius, is when you contradict yourself. Do you love your daughter or do you fucking hate bitches? I mean, come on, you're contradictory.
Are you upset at somebody for saying one thing?
I gotta take a shit.
Oh, God.
What? He's always on Twitter again. That's
always
why.
On the toilet.
I'm tweeting right now. Oh. And shitting.
Do you just listen to us when you're shitting?
Oh, it's toilet humor.
Oh, I walked into that one.
I call how I see it. You know, Eminem sucks, and you guys have toilet humor. I like it. Hold on a second.
Oh, my God.
God almighty.
Yeah, I got something for you, Eminem. I've got a trap here. You're out there running your mouth in front of cars. You're just a bite-sized snack while I'm serving the world candy bars. Giving Obama all the props. Stop no one want a hearing from a man who was addicted to the Valium lollipops. Yeah, I'm Trump. What the fuck? Believe me, Marshall. You may be a great guy, but I'm strong, and you're weak. You're falling off this game, and I've got to pee. You're a loser. Drug abuser. I'm the POTUS. And when my term is up, I'll be the dopest.
There you gotta call.
I gotta call. Melania. Melania's called me. She's embarrassed right now. She's all, please get off the get off.
Are the toilet sounds part of the song?
What? Hold on. Oh, wait. I forgot.
Who's calling me right now?
Now he's on hold, I think.
Yeah, well, I was calling tech support at the same time. I told you guys before, you shouldn't be surprised about this type of stuff, because I'm a multitasker. It's why I'm POTUS.
You're running the country.
I take shits. I freestyle. I listen to Eminem. I hate on Alec Baldwin. I hate on SNL.
You wait in line for tech support.
I hate on Miley Cyrus. I back up. Who's that bitch from Twilight? I hate her too. I have time for her as well. And I am on hold with tech support because I'm having issues with my computer. I apparently look at too much black porn.
They're calling you back, sir.
Anyways, are you ready for news, Andrew?
I can be ready for news.
All right, let's get ready.
Please, God.
To rumble. You know what? I don't even have news. This is a shit show. You guys are going to have to talk for a moment here.
I cannot believe that Donald Trump tried to freestyle.
He had it for a minute.
If Trump could freestyle, you can.
No, that's a false statement, Tony.
I think you need motivation.
I really think if Aunt Thomas really wanted to, the guy has a piercing in his dick, yep. Piercing in his nipples.
He gets his
asshole waxed.
Let me be your
hype man. I'm sure the next staff secrets will find out he gets his asshole bleached. But he's afraid to actually put a little bit of soul into his rap.
You know, yeah, I think
you need a hype man. Let me be your hype man.
I need Tony's help. That's what I need.
Oh, please no. Let's just move.
Hard work. Dedication. Hard work.
Let's move in the news, please. Please. Please.
I ate a bunch of cum.
Yes, you did.
Common knowledge. Just come with my butt.
Oh, jeez.
I ate a bunch of cum.
And now it's time for news with Andrew.
To start things off, we have a British man hides in the woods for 10 years to escape his wife's nagging.
No. Sounds about right.
A British man said...
Seriously?
Yeah. A British man said he hid in the woods for 10 years to escape his wife. Malcolm Applegate, age 62, said he left his wife after she continued to argue with him over his increased work hours as a gardener.
Mm-hmm.
For 3 years straight, we got on with one another and the gardening got too much for her, Applegate said. He said that the more work he took on, the angrier his wife became. She eventually demanded that he cut back on his work schedule, which led to Applegate leaving. Without a word to anyone, not even family, I packed up and left, he said. After 3 years of marriage, Applegate just up and left in his home in Birmingham and traveled by foot to London.
Where?
Because Birmingham?
Okay.
And traveled by foot to London because his bike was stolen along the way.
Oh.
He camped in the woods with
what if Debo stole it? Oh, wait. A room full of white people. Sorry.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
He camped in the woods with two other individuals and worked on gardens at a community center.
I need to get some black
elderly
people in there. Like ASAP.
You do.
I need to get some people I can connect with. Because you white people just not cutting it.
You're going ghetto to counteract my whiteness?
I need some blacks.
You need some blacks.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to get the next shirt. Next Rain Man Show shirt is I need some blacks.
Is it going to be black on black?
That's what I need. Huh. I'm going to. Can you actually specifically ask for a race? Is that inappropriate in the workplace?
I think yes.
I need blacks.
I think so.
I think it starts with a slave ship.
Oh my God. Holy crap.
Moving on.
The gardener spent a decade away from his wife and family, but he finally reconnected with his sister after writing her a letter.
Oh, wow. A letter. Okay.
It has been a decade. It has been a decade years since I'd last seen her, and in that time, she has been to all of the Salvation Army hostels in the South trying to follow me.
That's kind of a dick move to completely leave and abandon everyone so they think you're dead or something. Yeah. Because your wife was annoying and you didn't want to
get
divorced.
How about you just get divorced?
Yeah.
I mean, that's so much easier. You're living in the woods like a homeless individual.
This isn't a Tolkien novel. You don't just get to go on an adventure and then pen a letter 10 years later and like, oh, that's where he's been. The fucking woods. I should have known. Like,
it's okay, though, because he then goes on to say, we now have a great relationship again.
Yeah, what about the wife who left him?
With the wife, apparently. Left him.
Interesting.
And that's all we got about the man in the woods, unfortunately.
Okay.
So moving on. With Alphabet's Project Wing, it now delivers burritos by drone in southeastern Australia. Oh, we're going back to the woods.
My dearest Margaret, I hope this letter finds you well after 10 years living amongst the tree people. I don't know how to use a phone anymore since they're not plugged into the wood. I've taken up tobacco smoking and whittling in my spare time, and I find them both quite relaxing.
Oh, Frodo, go back home to your wife. She loves you.
I can't, Sam. Don't you understand? It's been 10 years. That's why I'm writing this letter.
Let me carry your burden for you, Frodo.
It does need to be mailed.
It's what I do best.
If you could take it to the post office.
Let me cop your balls, Frodo.
Well, that's something else.
Let me hold it for you and cradle it.
Oh, Sam.
Let me cozy up to your foreskin. Let me get inside and where it's cozy and warm.
Let me put this pen down. We're spilling ink everywhere.
But don't go back to your wife. You belong to me now, Frodo. You belong to me. Now put this cock ring on. That's the real run ring.
Our shame is invisible.
This is a gay, like...
It's a gay romance right here.
Yeah.
Yep.
We're shipping live on the air.
Yep.
All right. What else do we have in the news, Andrew?
Alphabet's Project Wing now delivers burritos by drone in southeastern Australia.
Oh, Gandalf, watch where you stick that stuff.
I have no memory of this place.
Did you bring the big firecrackers with you, Gandalf? I love the big firecrackers because they go boom.
We call this one the dragon. Watch out now.
Apparently the queen is a hobbit.
Apparently. She's British.
I like the Shire. Gandalf has his staff. He just waves it to and fro. And then, of course, Frodo is yay height, perfect for going down on me. He doesn't even have to go down.
The queen visits often.
This is a great place.
I find I drink a lot more marmalade afterwards.
It's been a while since we last heard from Project Wing, X's moonshot drone delivery project.
Oh, your load is warm.
But after a few fallow months, the team posted an update today, and it looks like the project has made quite some progress. Alphabet's X unit is now testing the Project Wing drones in southeastern Australia, where its flying machines are making deliveries right to its testers' yards.
Are you that lazy, though?
Hey, if Chipotle did drone delivery, I'd be on it. Extra walk, please.
I just imagine like burrito bombings accidentally. If you're somebody, if it like malfunctions and you lose your food.
I'd be okay with that.
It's a car windshield.
Just look up with your mouth wide open.
Those Chipotle burritos will kill it,
like
dude.
Frodo did.
Yeah. Just look. Just, apparently, there was the Shire was a test market. Hey, Frodo, we're going to start delivering big, girthy burritos right directly into your mouth. Make sure when you're walking, you just look up and keep that mouth wide open. Gullet and all. It needs a slide all the way down.
The leprechaun community has been taken quite a fondness to me. All the air-dropped burritos seem to have done some damage to my throat, which is why I sound like an old man.
Hey, is that a callback? All right, there we go.
This being southeastern Australia, we're talking about some pretty sizable yards, but that's still a step forward for the project. Indeed, Google is now working with Guzman y Gomez to deliver Mexican food.
That's very different than guns.
Guzman?
I'm just saying, you went from guns to Guzman.
I did. And Chemist Warehouse.
One syllable to two syllables.
This is someone's job, which makes me laugh. Like, Google's involved with, what are you working on, Steve? Oh, yeah, air delivering burritos in parts of Australia.
Sweet. Sounds made up.
Like, how That's what we do here,
how
Google.
How do you pick up chicks at the bar with that?
With a drone.
Hey, what do you do for work?
I deliver
burritos. That's kind of stupid. Well,
I work for Google.
Via drones. Oh, that's kind of cool. Do you power it yourself? Yeah, I'm a pilot.
He's wearing a pilot's jacket.
Really? You're a pilot? Yeah. What do you fly? Deliver. Oh, UPS? FedEx? No, not exactly.
What would you say to deliver?
USPS? No. Nope. Well, what else is there? It's a fairly big company. Google. Ooh, Google? You're a pilot for Google? Do you fly like their executives around? Not exactly. Well, please, do tell. What do you do? Little burritos.
What was that?
Little burritos. Like, that's not cool anymore. I would totally do that, though. I'm such a poser. Yeah, like, I'm a pilot.
I got my
Googlings here. Got extra peanuts in my jacket pocket for you little kitties out there. Or chicks, if you want them.
You'd have a name and everything like Iceman.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm dangerous.
What would your pilot name? Pilot Burrito Mexican Michael Flores. What is your pilot name?
Come on. Why do I got to be Mexican?
It's burrito based. Come on.
El Mariachi, the pilot. Is that better for you, you racist white motherfucker? All right. What else?
The current Project Wing drones can fly about 120 kilometers per hour. And from what we can tell, the basic setup here is a drone that can take off and land vertically with the help of a dozen or more rotors and then switch
AKA to a fucking drone.
Yep. And then switch to vertical flight for going longer distances.
Hmm. It's not different technology. It's a damn drone.
The deliveries hang under the drone and are lowered to their final delivery point, so the drone itself does not have to land.
Interesting.
While Google doesn't say how big these drones are, we're not talking about a little DJI drone here, but rather a pretty sizable
craft.
What
did you say, DJI or DIY?
DJI.
What's a DJI?
DJI is a really big drone company. Anytime you see prosumer drone footage, they're usually using a DJI Phantom of some sort.
Apparently, I opened up the autistic dictionary.
Yeah, you shouldn't have done that.
All right.
The location in Australia is obviously...
Are we still on this?
Yeah,
I guess we're
taking it.
Next news. Holy Christ almighty.
Stevie Wonder performs the national anthem on his knees.
Yeah, he does.
Music legend Stevie Wonder continues to stand in solidarity with the NFL players that have protested racial injustice.
I think he, because he can't see, he doesn't realize it's just one knee. So he's been hearing taking the knee, and he's like, I'm on both knees. Is that right, guys?
Oh,
like,
geez.
Ah, Stevie, it's one knee.
You're just sitting.
One knee. Like, his agent's all like shit. I told him this would be great publicity, but I didn't realize he can't see this whole time. I took it for granted that he just knew it was kneeling. It was one knee, not two knees. My God. Be fired. He doesn't even know what he's doing. He can't even see. He might as well just lay down and do it. Just lay down. It all looks the same from every perspective, Stevie Wonder. So stand, kneel, sit, lay down, lay on your side, put your legs up in the air, because guess what? It's still just darkness to you. Oh!
By taking a knee during the Star Spangled Banner. Over the weekend, he demonstrated his support by performing the national anthem on his knees.
I love Stevie Wonder's music, but you know what? I mean, he doesn't really have a leg to stand on with this, because he was against gay love just 2 or 3 years ago. He said a bunch of comments about how gay people are confused and how it's not possible for gay individuals to love each other. How do they know that? They're probably just confused. Right. And then he backtracked once he realized he was going to be labeled as a bigot. But come on, you're kneeling for diversity, and yet you don't believe in gay love.
Yeah.
Give me a break.
During an appearance at the 2017 Formula One.
Why is Stevie Wonder gets gay sex anyways? Once again, it's all darkness to him. He doesn't even know what a dick looks like. How does he know he doesn't like
him? And how would he know what's actually going in his butthole, whose dick that was?
Well, women don't have dicks. So, I mean, that's
they can buy some pretty
clue there.
They can buy some pretty sizable dicks.
Jeez. Christ. Oh, Tony. He's a ha-ha.
Exactly. Again, scientist Tony. Scientist Tony.
Deductive reasoning.
Oh, my God. I want scientist Tony for Halloween. Please make that's a Tuesday. Please,
well, Tony,
make
how do you
happen.
Explain? How do you explain this then? I mean, if your reasoning is that Stevie Wonder can't even see which dick actually goes in him, could you take it from there?
The lack of sight that Stevie Wonder has is compensated by other senses, like touch, smell, taste.
Anal contraction?
Yeah, hearing. Hearing. He might be able to hear the sound waves
hear
coming.
Dicks?
He might be. Please, Thomas.
I'm sorry. I'm just trying to
please,
clarify.
Please, Thomas. This is the scientific.
I'm an eager student.
This is the scientific community talking. Like, again, Stevie Wonder's lack of sight and vision results in a heightened sensory experience with the touch, taste, smell,
no,
and
we
hearing.
Know that.
Yeah, it is a known fact, according to Alex Jones, that penises give off sound waves.
You know, Bill Nye the retarded guy. That's Tony.
No, I mean, think about it. You know, like when I open up my zipper.
Oh, God, he's not going to stop.
We must end the show. Oh, however, God. We will be back in a few minutes for the No Talent Autistic Post Show with Andrew.
Thank you for listening to The Rain Man Show with your host, Michael Flores, with hosts Tony Sabal and Thomas Cowley, Andrew Spindler with the news, audio guru Dustin Lucas. Produced by Michael Flores and Dustin Lucas. The Rain Man Show is a Cazador Productions and Rain Man Digital broadcast production. For all things Rain Man, go to rainmanshow.com.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Rain Man No Talent Autistic Post Show with your host, myself, Andrew. Laughing over there, we have Thomas.
With your host, myself, also then named Andrew. Oh, man. Dude, you know how to sell the opening of a show that's about autism.
Excellent.
Then we have a scientist of all over here as well.
Thank you very much.
So we had been discussing the scientist of all thing, or the Tony the scientist thing, in our last week's show.
I do want that to be, because he made a second appearance in this show. I want for, because we should have an episode on Halloween night. I would love to have Tony come into character or in costume, even we do some video or something, and see Tony Sabal or Sabal Science, however we want to call that, make an appearance.
I mean, after all, people are talking like nowadays people are believing the Earth is flat. They're thinking like, you know, like these weird hypotheses on climate change. So
I have expected you to say people believe the Earth is round. What losers.
Yeah, I know, exactly. These people, unbelievable. No, I sort of like to, if it was even possible, to get, you know, like questions from the audience.
Ooh.
Make it interactive.
They tweet at us or something.
Yeah,
and we take some Twitter, Facebook,
you know,
questions.
We take a question from the audience and then we go ahead and give them the truth,
the Sabal
scientific proof and truth
Now, quick question. What areas of science and or teaching are you a master of? Do you have a degree in history as well as science? Is it just biology?
I have a degree in psychology. I also have a degree in technology. And I have a
just technology.
I'm working on my degree in Scientology. So I have covered all of the ologies. What about
geology?
Geology.
Like getting your rocks
theology,
off?
You know, theology. Like gynecology, okay. You know, like, you know, surgicology.
That's
and like,
not a word. Anyway.
That's what you think. That's what you think.
So
wordology, yes, apparently,
exactly.
Too.
Exactly.
So you are saying you are 100% qualified to explain any phenomena.
Yes.
That somebody does not understand.
Exactly. Just as you are absolutely 110% autistic.
Absolutely.
I could explain exactly what the cause of your autism is, but we could like get to that.
We'll save that for another episode. Sure. Jesus God.
So I guess we have to do it now. If you want to if you have a phenomena that you want to have explained by scientist Sabal, tweet it at us at Rain Man Digital and hopefully that'll be
we'll see what we can do.
Yes, exactly.
Hopefully that'll be a bit.
It'll be like next year, you know, like Nobel Prize for Science, Tony Sabal.
Oh my God.
All right. Anyway,
I need the money anyway for the rocket.
I do want to talk about Michael's burned throat just a little bit.
Does it interest you that he talked about his things going down his throat?
I'm just confused at how you can get a cup of coffee, even like in a mug, and not realize that it's piping, boiling lava hot.
Well, I could see that because I've heard other people talk about how something was so hot they ate it, and only once it's in their mouth did they realize, oh, fuck, I've made a mistake. I mean, people have done that before. It's same thing, like you've touched something and then you're like, it doesn't hurt, it's not hot at first, and then it kicks in.
Sure, but how many times have you eaten a piece of pizza that's just too hot, and you take a bite, and you're just like, and you're just trying to, it's still in your mouth, right?
And yeah, and so his but immediate reaction was to drink
swallow.
It. Well, okay, some people are swallowers. Andrew, you should know all about
some
that.
Some spit, some swallow.
But I do like how it was started out the whole first, like, 20 minutes was explaining, no, trust me, Lori, the waxer, this is totally different than how I normally sound. I think he sounds fine.
He's
hard on himself,
it's
honestly.
It's just fine. It's fine. But I cannot imagine swallowing boiling water down into your body, because that's a straight up torture tactic.
Yeah, he almost died.
That's insane. I can't imagine how that would be.
The network was in jeopardy.
And nobody even knew it because he's going to die in the woods.
Yes, exactly.
Alone and unloved, apparently.
Surrounded by the porn of childhood.
We'd show up at the studio like, going, we're missing someone.
I like how you're assuming live. We broke into the house to get in here.
We're ready to go live.
Hypothetically, we'd show up. Maybe the door might have been unlocked. You know, maybe the dogs might have been able to open up the door.
Uh-huh. Apparently, according to scientist Sabal, dogs have the ability to work handles and doorknobs.
Dude, that's absolutely true.
Exactly.
Dogs know how doorknobs work.
I hate both of you.
So with the wax on, wax off promo, so you've used your services before.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Who do you think is going to get waxed?
My money says either myself or Bobby, because I've done it before.
Uh-huh.
And Bobby's up for almost anything.
You don't think that waxing you would be a cop out?
I don't think so. No,
because there would be no reaction there. You know, where it's like it's not 40-year-old virgin with Steve Carell.
It's not. In no way is it actually like the 40-year-old virgin with Steve Carell. That's the complete wrong way to do all of that. But I think that'll be fun. My concern is whoever's involved. How are we going to do cameras? Or is that going to be in a separate room? Or people are going to have to prepare to see some things.
Yeah, I'm excited.
But it's not as bad as the Rain Man couch is not as bad as the casting couch.
I don't know. Depends.
We here are volunteers.
And of all the stuff that Michael puts us through, we have all volunteered for it.
Yeah, repeatedly. Yeah, so absolutely. I think we're just the idiots then.
We just come back, you know, like wanting more, more and more. We just can't quit.
We're addicts.
Can't quit it.
Yeah.
I just can't quit you.
I think... This, speaking of the casting couch, though, we talked a fair amount about the Harvey Weinstein debacle and going on. And I know Mike was trying to be very careful about how he presented his argument. Yeah. But I think he did a good job articulating that there's an issue not just with one person. in this industry, and not even just that industry. There's issues going through, you know, religious bodies have this problem. Political groups have this problem. There's a serious problem going on.
Anyone did that's a celebrity right now.
And he, I thought, did a good job explaining that you can't just say one person's to blame for all of this, or you're not going to be able to solve the entire root of the problem by addressing a single weed. I thought he was well spoken with that. And I think hopefully people don't just run with a title and assume too much and actually listen to what he's saying.
So I'm actually kind of frustrated about that whole thing.
The incident in Hollywood?
No, about particularly Michael's stance. And I understand that he's doing a bit when we do like the news and stuff, and it comes up that, teachers.
What is your issue?
It comes up where teachers have had sex with their students.
Right.
Right. If it's a female teacher, it's a hot pass, that sort of thing. We do that whole bit and stuff. Right. But I always chime in like, this is not acceptable regardless of who's doing it.
Right. And we're not actually saying that.
I totally agree. But it just goes to further prove that there cannot be double standards. Everybody has to be held to the
But right there, his point stands that it's not just Hollywood that is having this issue. Look at our teachers are having this problem. You know, there's a serious problem with abuse of power when it comes to that entire concept. So everybody who lets something happen is just as much at fault as those who are directly involved. You know, like he said, it's going to take everybody to say this is unacceptable. And you can't tell me that all of this happened to all those people involved in the hashtag Me Too, that nobody was, everyone's, oh, wow, I had no fucking idea. No, come on. People knew.
So Hollywood is based around the whole reason Hollywood exists, with beautiful ladies and fantastic.
Because we like watching attractive people.
Right. But during the heydays and the silver screen days, sex scandals, like, that was how Hollywood was, strictly sex. Right.
There's a lot of that in its history.
Mm-hmm. Dude, it's
all the way back to Charlie Chaplin.
Charlie Chaplin had an obsession with young girls. He was effectively a pedophile.
Yeah, he was just like Roman Polanski. There's a whole thing with that. If you look in the history, there's a whole bunch of other things. Fatty Arbuckle's career died because of allegations like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not anything new. So I kind of, like Mike, I get annoyed when people act like they're all surprised when it's literally been documented for almost 100 years. How much more fucking evidence do you people need?
Elizabeth Taylor, from way back when, she had 8 marriages, and going on forward, she had numerous affairs.
I mean, there's movies like Hail Caesar, the Coen brothers movie, deals with some of that.
Yep.
It's throughout our culture, and yet we act so surprised when it comes to the limelight. But I think it's good that there's been a light shown on it, but I think people need to not be as naive to the abuse of power that exists, not just in Hollywood, but in every other industry.
Using that as a springboard, I had mentioned the Finders cult, right? I'm super, super into conspiracy theories, you know, paranormal.
This is the autistic hour, right?
This is the autistic hour, so I have to go.
Post show, not an hour. Right. Jesus God.
So the Finders cult, it was a huge political sex industry via trafficking children. And like this whole, there was this.
Was this the whole thing with the emails and the code words and shit?
No.
Is that something else? Even?
This happened in the late 90s.
Okay.
I think. But it was this credit union. This director of a credit union was living off of $15,000 a year. He's very clearly living outside of his means.
Mm-hmm.
He was under investigation. And whenever anybody got close to that investigation, the feds would just come and just say, stop. Like, that's it. Right.
Okay.
But this warehouse and everything, Michael's looking at me all funny. But this warehouse and everything, like, children went in and they didn't come out. And then next thing you know, pretty much. And these,
like the Roach Motel.
It was insane. When the Feldmans or when the Coreys say that they were being passed back and forth between Hollywood executives,
like being traded for baseball cards.
Take that, but turn it up to fucking 21. Not 10, 21.
Yeah.
Like, and it's nuts. And this is all politicians and all the Bushes were, or it must have been the early aughts then. Like, the Bushes were there. Like, Obama was.
It had to be early. It's been going on for years. Almost guaranteed.
It's insane.
It's been
weird
going on for years.
Nowadays, you know, like, I think in the past, they would have laughed like, oh, it's like Corey Feldman. He's like a nutcase.
Because
but now it's
you
like.
Could,
Now it's like all of a sudden, hey.
Because you could get away with things when not every single moment of every person's life was documented on the internet. And now that that's the case, people are slipping up or things are finally coming to the limelight, which is some good to be said about that in some ways. But at the same time, that's a whole other bag of issues.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the sad fact is, it's shit like this has been going on for a very long time.
Last thing I'll say about the Finder's Cult, if you want to have a fantastic in-depth look at that, there is a series called Satanic Practices in the Federal Government or something of that effect by Last Podcast on the Left. It's a three-part series. If you want to
we're
have
we're going to be like on a document, a government list now.
Oh, absolutely. They did a fantastic series. They did their research. They did production. Like it's absolutely phenomenal.
Well, we're not going to be the only ones on the list because the whole other bit of famous people on a list probably now is Eminem.
Oh,
himself.
For sure.
And that was probably my weakest moment on
I'm
this show as a whole.
I really am honestly disappointed in you.
In who? Eminem or
in
Thomas?
Me. In me.
Thomas. Thomas, I really am disappointed. This is an opportunity where you could have earned street cred.
See, there's...
And I just realized you have no soul.
I know what I am. I don't have that in me, so I don't pretend to be something else, but...
No, I just realized you have no soul.
I see that I need teachings from Wise Master Tony and how to be more street. Is that the proper vernacular?
When I am done with you, my friend, you will be more street and more scientifically, you know, knowledgeable.
So here's what I want to have happen. Tony, I want to have you train Thomas in the ways of the freestyle.
Ah,
okay? Is this going to be our own, like, half a mile because we're the retarded edition?
Yeah. And then I want to have you have a rap battle with Bobby.
Oh, God.
Thank you for joining us on the Rain Man No Talent Autistic Post Show. We'll see you next time. Buzz your butt.